Every rock has a story to tell. No matter what kind of rock or where you find it, it preserves evidence of its history, and we can learn to decipher that history. Take, for example, the rock in the Science Center lobby. This piece of mica schist, now serving as a wall decoration, started its life long before the dinosaurs. It has undergone many changes as it has traveled many miles, both horizontally and vertically, over hundreds of millions of years. Its story starts about 450 million years ago, on the east coast of the proto-North American continent, where rivers flowed into the ocean. The muddy sediment carried by the rivers slowly settled out in the quiet water beyond the waves. Over hundreds of thousands of years, more mud was deposited every year, gradually accumulating to form a thick layer. During this time, the Iapetus Ocean was gradually decreasing in size, because the tectonic plate carrying the Proto-African continent was converging with the Proto-North American plate. The western leading edge of the Proto-African plate bent down and subducted underneath the eastern edge of the Proto-North American plate. The presence of a deep oceanic trench along this subduction zone allowed a great thickness of sediments eroded from the proto-North American continent to accumulate. The increasing weight of overlying younger sediments caused the mud to be compacted and cemented into a fine-grained sedimentary rock called shale. Eventually, the Iapetus Ocean floor was completely subducted, allowing Proto-Africa to collide with proto-North America, forming the supercontinent of Pangaea. Continents have too low a density to be subducted, so continent-continent collisions cause intense deformation of the sedimentary rocks caught in between. Our shale layer was buried even deeper and folded like an accordion. This compression caused the clay minerals in the shale to be rotated into alignment perpendicular to the compression, and the higher temperature at this depth caused the clay minerals to recrystallize into somewhat larger mica grains, forming a metamorphic rock called slate. Clay minerals and micas all have a crystal structure made up of thin sheets of atoms that are strongly bonded within each sheet, but have very weak bonds between each sheet. Graphite has a very similar crystal structure, which is why it is used in pencils. When you write on a page with one, you brush off thin sheets of carbon atoms. When clay minerals and micas become strongly aligned in a rock that is squeezed, the rock itself develops a fine scale layering, or foliation, along which it tends to break most easily, much like the pages in a book. Thus, the orientation of the foliation in an ancient metamorphic rock preserves a record of the plate compression direction. Continued compression between the two continents further deformed the rocks. It formed the very high ancestral Appalachian Mountains, and also formed, correspondingly, deep roots. This deformation caused the slate to be buried somewhat deeper, where the temperature was even greater. This in turn caused the mica grains to grow even larger in size, forming the sparkly silver-colored muscovite we see today, and transforming the rock from a slate into a mica schist. After the Appalachian Mountains reached about as high as the present Himalayas, the two continents could not converge anymore, and so the mountains began to slowly erode. About 200 million years ago, there was a reversal of plate-spreading directions, which caused the supercontinent of Pangaea to rift apart, and the present Atlantic Ocean began to open. The rifting created valleys like the African rift valleys of today, and dinosaurs left their footprints in the mud along lake shores in present-day Connecticut and Massachusetts. The Appalachian Mountains continued to be eroded during this time. Glaciers and rivers and landslides gradually wore them down, lower and lower, transporting sediments downhill and ultimately depositing them in the growing Atlantic Ocean. As the mountain peaks were lowered by erosion, the total mass above ground decreased. To compensate for this, the mountain roots rose buoyantly upward, just like an iceberg that melts on the top is replenished by the buoyant rise of its root. Thus, over tens of millions of years, the once deeply buried mica schist was passively uplifted closer and closer to the Earth's surface. The schist was finally exposed at the surface within the recent Pleistocene Ice Age, when ice sheets originating in northern Canada scraped south across New England multiple times. And then only very recently, a geologist found the mica schist in New Hampshire,
took it back to Brown and put together its amazing story.